And similar to any other maxillary or mandibular premolar or any other natural teeth, the labial surface is in a curved plane, and you can broadly classify the plane into gingival half and incisal half. So we will also have depth orientation grooves accordingly. So for the incisal half, we will have three grooves, 1, 2 and also 3, and for the cervical half we'll have 2 grooves. So it's same like canine or a central incisor or any other anterior teeth. And for this preparation also I'm going to use a straight round ended cylinder which is about 1 millimeter in diameter. So my depth orientation grooves will be 1 millimeter in diameter everywhere. So I will reduce the tooth all around to about 1 millimeter, except for the occlusal surface, which will require about 1.5 millimeter of reduction on an average. But on the functional cusp, which is the palatal cusp, so a functional cusp is a cusp which occludes with the fossa of the central fossa of the opposing teeth. So for a maxillary premolar, it will be the, or any other maxillary teeth, it will be the palatal cusps which will be considered as the functional cusps, and the labial cusps will be considered as non-functional cusps. So reduction in functional cusp area will be about 1.5 to 2 millimeters, and reduction in non-functional cusp area will be about 1 to 1.5 millimeters. Okay, and we also have something called as functional cusp bevel, which is similar to a bevel which we give on the incisal edge of the anterior teeth. So what is the functional unit of anterior teeth? So the part of the teeth which is going to cut through the food, incise the food, we can call that as a functional unit. So it's the incisal edge for the anteriors. Similarly, for the posterior teeth, it will be functional cusp will be the side of the will be the cusp that will be occluding with the central fossa of the opposing teeth, which will be the palatal cusp. So all the palatal cusps will be considered as functional cusps. So you will have a 45 degree bevel which will be between the occlusal surface and the axial surface in this area, in order to increase the thickness for the restoration. Let me start with the labial preparation. So we have marked our depth orientation grooves, demarcating the tooth into two planes, the incisal plane and the gingival plane. Okay. So let me start preparing the depth orientation grooves. I'm going to start with the labial surface, but it is also okay to start with the occlusal surface, like how we started with the incisal edges of the anterior teeth. However, since the labial surface is much more visible and much more important in preparation, we will first go ahead with labial preparation. There is no strict criteria, but you can either start with labial side or labial surface, or you can also start with the occlusal surface. So I'm planning to start with the labial surface. So now I'll start making the depth orientation grooves. I've made three grooves, so all these three grooves would be about 1 millimeter in depth, approximately the same as the size of the diameter of the burr which I'm using. So after making these grooves, like as usual, we will connect these grooves to make a flat plane. Like a canine, the premolar's labial surface is also like almost like a four-planed surface, like mesial, distal, and also incisal and gingival. So when you prepare the labial surface, you will have a central ridge, a mild central elevation between the mesial side and the distal side. So now I'm going to connect the grooves. I've finished connecting one of the grooves, sorry, the central groove with the mesial groove. Now we have the distal groove left behind. We will finish connect that also with the central groove. I have finished connecting the grooves, and now I will start with the gingival half grooves, depth orientation grooves for the gingival half. It's the same rule as the anterior teeth. So when you're preparing the labial half, your burr will be slightly tilted towards the palatal surface, and when you're preparing the gingival half, your burr will be straight parallel to the long axis of the tooth. Okay, so two grooves for the gingival half. I'll keep the burr as parallel to the long axis as possible. One, and two. Now the grooves are complete. Let me connect them and finish my labial surface preparation, gingival half of the labial surface preparation. So the grooves have been connected. Now our labial surface preparation is almost complete. If you see from the anteroposterior view, you can see like the tooth is slightly prepared in two planes, not in a straight plane. You can easily see the first plane here and then the second plane here. So when I touch the lower half of the tooth, you can see it's not, the burr is not contacting the upper half, which means upper half is curving towards the palate. So it's like two planes, one plane below for the gingival half and another plane above for the cuspal half or the incisal, sorry, occlusal half. Now when we look at the occlusal surface, look from the occlusal surface, you can see there is a central ridge between the mesial half and the distal half of the already prepared labial surface. And now for the occlusal surface, also we have to mark depth orientation grooves. So depth orientation for groove for the occlusal surface will be like one groove here, one groove here. So there must be one groove connecting the cusp tip to the central fossa on either side, cusp tip to the central fossa. So this is the cusp tip and this is the central fossa, and there also should be grooves along the end of the depression areas of the cusp. So we will have three grooves on the labial half and three grooves on the palatal half. So these grooves on the sides, these four grooves on the sides are secondary grooves, and instead of making a groove, you can also make a small dip using a round burr, or you can use the cylindrical burr and to make a small depression, a dimple of about 1 millimeter. So dimple is like a small circular depression. So you can use a round burr which is about 1 millimeter diameter, or you can use this same cylindrical burr to make a small dip. So on one side I will make a groove, and on the other side I will make a small dimple, so that you can appreciate both the ways of making depth orientation preparations. So for the label side, I will make the grooves. So we have made the first groove, which will connect the cusp tip to the central fossa, and now we will make two secondary grooves on either side of this. So now we will connect the grooves to make two planes, one plane from the distal side and another plane on the mesial side. I'm connecting all the grooves. So now I've completed the occlusal surface, occlusal reduction for the labial cusp. Now I'll be doing the occlusal reduction for palatal cusp. First we'll begin with making a depth orientation groove. So we have made three grooves. Now I'll be connecting the grooves. So we have completed the occlusal surface preparation. So we will have a central ridge running from palatal cusp tip to the central fossa, and also another central ridge running from labial cusp, the buccal cusp, to the central fossa, and you'll have a central groove, and you'll have a small island of teeth left behind in both the triangular fossa area. Okay, so this elevation is not supposed to be present. But when we finish the proximal reduction, when we cut through the tooth like this, this elevation will be automatically removed from the surface of the tooth. Okay. So now we will start with the proximal surface reduction, distal and mesial. It's the same like how we did for canines. So imagine a premolar is like a canine with a palatal cusp. Okay, so now let us start with the mesial proximal surface reduction. So it's the same thing, keep the burr touching the bottom of the finish line and slowly move it up like this multiple times until you slowly break through the contact and reach to the palatal side. Okay, just follow how I'm doing. 1, 2, 3, 4. So from bottom, slightly up, repeat the same thing until you reach to the palatal side. Slightly reduced, You can see the difference between the mesial side and the distal side. The mesial side is slightly deeper. So I'll keep continuing this motion from bottom upwards like this until I break through and go to the palatal side. If you feel like you don't have control by using this cylindrical burr, you can switch over to a thin needle like burr. So for beginners it will be difficult to use this burrs of such a thickness to break through the contacts without damaging the neighboring tooth. So if you feel it is difficult, you can use a thin pointed burr for breaking through the contact. You can see the contact is broken now on the mesial side. Now we'll be doing the same thing for the distal proximal surface. Okay. Bottom up. Halfway through on the distal proximal surface, I will continue and I will break through the contact and I will reach the palatal side, same like how it is on the mesial side. Now you can have a look, we have finished breaking through the distal contact also. Now we have not prepared the palatal axial wall, axial surface, and also we have not done anything for increasing the thickness of restriction in the functional cusp area, that is the palatal cusp area. So the final thing would be the functional cusp bevel after reducing the palatal surface. So to reduce the palatal surface again, we can make one single depth orientation groove over here. For the palatal surface, it's actually more straight. You don't have to prepare it in two planes. You can just make it in one plane. And since we are going to make a bevel for the functional cusp, the bevel will act like a second plane on the palatal surface. So there is no need for preparing the palatal surface into two different planes. You can just prepare it along the prepare it parallel to the long axis of the tooth. So I'll make a groove approximately 1 millimeter in depth. So we have made a groove. Now we will be cutting off the portion of enamel which lies between the proximal surfaces and the palatal groove. Okay, so we need to move the burr around like this, and the reduction will be accomplished. So we have finished reduction on the distal side. Now we will reduce on the mesial side. By the way, preparing the palatal surface of maxillary teeth is the most difficult thing to accomplish, and usually you will have to use the mouth mirror as a reflection of the mouth mirror to look at the teeth. So since this is a demonstration and since I have to shoot the video, I am not using a mouth mirror. I am doing it like I am looking at it directly. But you must remember in your mind that your patient cannot be tilted so backwards or so down like that to have a perfect visibility like how we have now in this video. So always remember to practice to set your diphthongs into the mannequins and practice preparing them like how you prepare them for the patient. Do not angulate the burr or your working instrument from the posterior side, because that is not how your instrument is going to come have an entry into the patient's mouth. It's always from the anterior side. So always use your handpiece or any other instrument that you're going to use from anterior direction, so that you will get accustomed to the way about the how you prepare, how you will be doing it, doing the same procedure inside the patient's mouth. Now I have refined the axial surface, and when you look from above, it's almost like a ovoid cross section. With the central ridge on the labial surface, and on the palatal surface you don't actually have a central ridge. It's like a more like a smooth curve from mesial to distal, and the proximal reductions also have been accomplished. So we have approximately about 1 millimeter of proximal reduction on either side. So this will give space for both your metal and ceramic in case of metal ceramic, and also adequate bulk in case of all ceramic materials. So now when you look from the anterior, you can see like there are two peaks of the cusps, the labial cusp and the palatal cusp. So these two peaks are like converging or sloping down to the to a central groove. So this is how the cusp is actually present in natural teeth before preparation, also. But there should be something done on the palatal cusp, which is the functional cusp for the maxillary teeth, which is like a 45 degree bevel, approximately 45 degrees angle to the occlusal surface preparation. So this bevel will increase the thickness of the restoration in this area, because in this area we will have lot of stress and force concentration. So if the restoration is too thin, the restoration might chip or fracture or wear away much faster comparatively. So this particular area should have the most reduction for maxillary teeth. So now I will be making a bevel, the functional cusp bevel, 45 degrees between palatal axial wall and the palatal cuspal surface. Okay, so you can actually make a small groove also, but it is much easier because we have almost completed the entire preparation and the tooth is really very small, so you don't have to actually make a depth orientation groove. You can just slightly flatten and bevel this surface and you'll eventually achieve the reduction that is required, which is about 1.5 to 2 millimeters for metal ceramic or any other all ceramic restoration. Okay, so I'm going to make the bevel now. Can see I have made the bevel. Nice 45 degree bevel between crystal surface and the parallel surface. Yes. Now, if you take a look, I have completed the preparation. You can see the occlusal surface is now like in three planes. One plane on the buccal cusp converging towards the central fossa, and one plane for the palatal cusp converging towards the central fossa, and there is another bevel which is like a third plane. It is about 45 degrees between occlusal surface and palatal surface. Okay, and you can also see the proximal reduction fairly good enough. I mean, like fairly deep enough. There is enough space for both the metal and ceramic, in case of metal ceramic, and also for the all ceramic. And now, if you look at the clearance, the tooth has cleared nice and good with both the neighboring tooth and also the opposing tooth. So this brings us to the preparation of maxillary second premolar for receiving a metal ceramic crown. Thank you. Have a nice day. Look at the labial surface. It's again not a straight surface. It's prepared in two planes. You can easily see there are two planes. The gingival plane and the occlusal plane. Occlusal plane is slightly inclined towards the palatal surface, and the gingival plane is made parallel to the long axis of the tooth. When you look from above, you must be able to see all the margins, which means there are no undercuts. The taper is fairly good enough. Yes. Okay. So this brings us to the end of preparation of maxillary premolar. Thank you.